Brattleboro Gallery Walk goes virtual.
Where are we?
We are at Cy Silver Gallery, West Brattleboro.
You know, I've been by here, but I've never been in here, so it's pretty exciting for me.
I'm embarrassed to say the same, but I'm excited to be here for the first time, and I think it's kind of cool that this program has enabled us to do that.
Well, whose work is this?
This is the work of Rodrigo Nava. He is a sculptor who works in steel, I believe. I believe it's steel, inflated steel. Feels like a balloon, but it's weighted like a metal object and rusty like a metal object, so it has that interesting juxtaposition.
You're watching Virtual Gallery Walk.
Had size dim sum
at the farmer's market in the summer? No, never.
No, what?
I'm kidding.
But you can get it here as well, right?
Yep, they do curbside.
Curbside pickup.
Yep.
I'm Cy Silver. I'm the co-founder and director for this CX Silver Gallery. And I'm also artist and teacher. So all my life is doing art and enjoying being in the art world.
Mm-hmm. I think I pronounced it wrong. I always think that it's Cy Silver for some reason, but it's CX Silver Gallery. Is that right?
Yeah, CX Silver Gallery.
The X is for she, X-I, that's her maiden name. Sai She. I'm
Adam
Silver, so I'm partners with Sai with this. Sai is the owner, chef, and founder, and I guess if she's the CEO, I'm the CFO, and collaborate, and I also edit and publish our work, our books on art and artists. This is Nye.
Hi, Nye.
Hello. So I've been with the gallery since 2014, when I had my 50th retrospective show, a show of 50 years of my work.
And you do, what kind of work do you do? I've read about your work and I've seen your work for years, but how would you describe it?
Oh my goodness, well, words get into it a lot because I am a poet and have been all my life. For instance, these, which I call calligraphies, but that's with my tongue in my cheek because they are stenciled. And that is a quote from a play by Gertrude Stein, which was called What Happened? And it says, messages are received all the time.
They win. You judge they win.
I'm not sure that's true, but I was feeling it strongly at the time. I think if you get into judgmentality, then nobody wins.
Yeah, Chairpiece is a huge installation. It's like 25 feet long, and it's made up of chairs.
Yeah, this is with the democratic principles going down the drain. You can see right there, they're going, except nowadays in this current administration, you can put a lot more democratic principles, right? Going down the drain.
Oh, yeah.
This is the one about stolen voting.
Stolen voting?
What is it? It's like a voter suppression. And, and there you have Chad's.
Nobody even knows what chads are anymore.
It's a reference to the...
Some of us remember.
It's a reference to the 2000 Florida...
Yeah.
Debacle.
Election debacle where Gore was supposed to win.
So Fluxus is a
movement
that I have been part of for years. And so
an art movement, you should say. Art movement, for those of you.
It's like a laboratory of experimenting, pushing the boundaries of art since the 60s.
So Tempus Fugit is what people say, but I put Tempus Fluxit. And the hands point where they will.
Showing dividends, and I said, I bet I could get a haiku on there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wrote down the name of the company and called them up, and they said, sure, you get 117 characters. It's
an endless loop.
It just circulates.
Uh-huh. It's a piece of cloth. Ribbon that goes round and round.
Gives birth.
That's probably technology, dating back to the 20s or 30s or something, right?
Yes. And right here are two other pieces which are over 50 years old. These are both amazing installations from the 60s.
They were from my first show.
Yeah, this is called Defrost the American Flag and Dinner Service. This has been shown all over the place, including like Europe and everywhere.
I found this little piece of steel tape on the ground, and I mounted it, and it says
failure to measure up.
That's right, failure to measure up.
Yeah,
I called it.
I love it. You're such a word-based, your humor and your sensibility.
So I was thinking of that as many times in my life it was autobiographical. Do you know that most of the men who saw it thought it was about their privates?
I can imagine. Yeah.
I'm shocked.
Wow. So like I said, whatever's on your mind
right.
is what comes up.
Yeah.
Oh, and speaking of found objects, that's a Fluxus Valentine straight ahead.
Yes, I was packing to move and I had an old douchebag. And I said, I don't use this anymore. I was about to chuck it. And then I saw that the hose made a heart. And then there was Cupid's arrow coming out the bottom. So I just put press type on it. Yep. And made it into a Valentine.
Yeah. I think that's one of my all-time favorites. Now, in fact, more so now with the fascist pending qualities of our administration, as it was during the Vietnamese War, right?
Yeah.
The Vietnam War.
Right. I was just writing about the Nazi national anthem, and when I came to Über Alles, which is Deutschland, Deutschland, Über Alles, which means overall or number one. I said, oh, it begins and ends with U.S.
Wow, wow, I didn't see that. Yeah.
And I thought of us as just us being humans. Like, what are we doing to people? Not only U.S., but us as humans. What are we doing?
Right.
These humble journals are the Friday Book of White Noise. This has never been seen before, published before, except for half-page snippets in John Cage's anthology. This plus a couple of digitized versions is the entire thing. And this is like 5 years worth of Nye and her former husband, Jeff. But about 80% is Nye. Because it was Friday is the Friday book of White Noise. So it's like all of the origin of some of the ideas and concepts that came that developed into Fluxus pieces for years. And all of the little sticky notes are like annotations that we're going to develop into this, and we're going to do a facsimile edition of this.
Did you really?
But yeah, so over the years, you know.
Uh-huh.
Really, I love classical stuff, but I grew up in Scotland, so sort of mix of classical and fiddle tunes and stuff, so, yeah.
What made you come to the United States?
I was doing research in the atmosphere.
Really?
The ozone hole back then. So yeah, that was 25 years ago now. Yeah. But it's good.
Yeah. Do you do similar things here or?
Not now. I program computers. So I was doing modeling of the atmosphere.
Oh,
so,
okay.
Yeah, so it just sort of morphed into programming. So.
Yeah. For who?
I'm self-employed. So
nice. So do you just do like contract work or?
Yes, yeah. I can get it. It's a little bit iffy at the moment, but.
Thank you.
are here at our next location, the River Gallery School of Art.
Welcome. We are River Gallery School, Gallery 34. This is Lydia Thompson. She is an artist exhibiting in Gallery 34.
I started making this work after I took a workshop with the artist Paul Bowen, where we use walnuts from his tree to pound and make into walnut ink. And I began actually with this piece. I just was on my deck one day, and a friend, Susan Osgood, had given me some of this interesting paper, and I just started drawing a geranium that was growing there. And I was intrigued by the way the ink was working and the way it was resisting and soaking in interesting ways. So I just started to get very intrigued with the material and how I could erase, draw with it and erase with it and paint with it. And from there, I've just started exploring I started with a lot of field and garden plants. This is Joe Pieweed. And we just go out and pick something and bring it back in and start drawing it and then painting it. And I just had a lot of fun exploring what the ink does, scratching it off and putting it on.
What kind of differences have you noticed between the walnut ink and other inks that you might have used before that?
Well, it's not permanent. So I'm able to take it off. Like if I put a drop of water on it, I can lift it. So I can get back to light. So I can bring light back in, which is one of my favorite parts of it. And I can evaporate it and get it really thick and almost gooey and then get really dark with it. So the other thing I've done is toned the paper with a wash of walnut ink, and the variations. I really like this, you know, the paper had some fault in it. So I've just been enjoying the variations that pop up with it and trying to make it work. But a lot of it is taking off what I've put on. So I like that subtractive part of it too. Yeah.
I noticed that a lot of your pieces are nature. I was wondering if they're that theme just to reflect the walnut and how it is a part of nature?
Well, maybe not consciously, but yes, that's my interest right now. And maybe you're right, and I haven't identified it, but maybe the walnut ink is particularly suited for drawing things like that. I haven't drawn any walnuts, but maybe that's a good idea. Paul Bowen, who's a sculptor and an artist who draws and mostly sculpts, offered this workshop in making it, and it just sounded intriguing to me. It's a standard artist medium. It's you can buy it if you want to buy it. But the fun part was he gathered the walnuts and then he let them kind of rot in his garage for a while until they got really mucky. And then we spent hours pounding them and straining them and making them into ink, all of which seemed really interesting to me. So from there, I don't know, it just seemed to me that these natural subjects were the right subjects for drawing with it. I've done a couple of portraits, actually, with it, so it's not all botanical sort of things. Then I did a few fishy things, and crows are always an interest of mine, so some of that, too. But mostly I'll just go outside and like pick radishes or, you know, pick something or get something from the co-op. But mostly just bring something in and look at it and start working on it. This is the walnut ink, and it's...
Oh, wow.
This is kind of evaporated and sludgy. It's got, you know, the goo on the bottom, but you can dilute it, which is what I do when I do the background. I dilute it, but you can also make it really rich and dark.
Since the walnut doesn't really show a range of colors like you might if you were using rainbow paints, have you noticed that it forces you to come up with different ways to show texture and shadow?
Yeah, exactly. And I think And I think that's what my interest is in. Sometimes I scrub them, but a lot of it has to do with when you're in a monochromatic scheme like this with just one color, you need to be able to control the lights and the darks. And you also need to be able to bring some interest in with different textures. So when I discovered that I could take, that I could put a drop of water on and take, get back to the white, that to me, it was very exciting because then it allows you like a third color. You have the base color and the dark color and the tones in that, but also to be able to get back to white felt exciting to me, to be able to bring that light and life back into the drawings occasionally, yeah. But it's different, you know, I call them drawings, but I do them with a paintbrush. I don't know if they're drawings or paintings. They have the quality of drawings, I think. But they're kind of painterly too.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Johann Frederick. Thank you.
Thank you.